Well, thank you all for having me here. It's a pleasure to be here on one of our rare rain days. Nice to get to experience all of the Southern California weather. So today I'm going to talk a lot about a recent natural disaster that the Chimane have experienced, but I'm also going to kind of talk about first some endocrine health work that we've been working on under normal physiological circumstances. And then we'll talk about what changes during a major shock like this. And so what I'm really interested in doing is applying life history to human health to understand how natural selection has shaped and optimized trade-offs between reproduction and survival, health and physiology across the lifespan. And much of what I'm going to talk about today is from an endocrine perspective, because the endocrine system is really important in terms of a lot of hormones are mediators of these trade-offs that we see. So if you're trading off between parenting and reproduction, a lot of those trade-offs are tied to specific hormones, both behavioral but also physiologically. And one of the things that we need to really keep in mind is that natural selection optimized all these trade-offs under very different energetic conditions than those experienced today. So we can all go and hunt and gather 20,000 calories from McDonald's or from the hallway, but that wasn't always the case throughout most of human history. We're in a much more energy-limited setting with a much higher parasite and pathogen load than that which is experienced today. And so I think that really understanding these trade-offs under the more evolutionarily relevant environmental circumstances is really important. And so that's why I work with a population known as the Chimane, forage horticulturalists in the Bolivian Amazon. And populations like this are really important because almost all of our medical knowledge has been developed in these sedentary, Western, educated, industrialized, rich, democratic populations under very different energetic conditions than those faced throughout most of human history. And this isn't just important for understanding the evolution of human health and physiology, but there are nearly a billion people today, as estimated by the UN, who are undernourished worldwide. So this isn't just a problem of understanding our past, but also our present. And so I'm first going to start off by talking about some of these trade-offs under, like I said, normal physiological conditions. And then we're going to move to talk about these changes when the system is shocked. And so a lot of the trade-offs that I'm going to talk about today are related to testosterone. But I'm not really, testosterone is just one hormone. We could do the same thing with estrogen, we could do it with progesterone, we could do it with ghrelin or adiponectin. But testosterone is just one of the many ways we can study these trade-offs. And one of the reasons why it's so important is that testosterone controls a lot of the secondary sexual characteristics in males across many different taxon species. In humans, we know that testosterone is vitally important for muscle mass, can modify face shape during development and voice pitch. But one of the things with this high testosterone phenotype is that it entails a number of energetic costs. So in human males, muscle mass uses an estimated 20% of basal metabolic rate. Testosterone also has these anabolic and catabolic effects, meaning that it can help put on additional muscle mass, which will then be energetically expensive, but it can also burn off body fat. And that sounds great for us, but if body fat is your somatic reserves, then it's not necessarily something that you want to burn off really quickly and rapidly. Testosterone is also associated with competitive, aggressive, risky, and mate-seeking behaviors, all of which can be quite energetically expensive. But one of the things is that nothing occurs in a vacuum, and we have a lot of other physiological processes ongoing at any given time. And so one of those is immune function, and immune function is really energetically expensive. So if you have a severe infection, something like sepsis or burns, that causes about a 25 to 50% increase in resting metabolic rate. There's been some work looking at even just really minor insults, so things like a flu vaccine. These really minor insults where you don't even get a fever, those still cause about a 10 to 14% increase in resting metabolic rate. And when you get these large energetic requirements, then that forces a trade-off. And one of the things that we see is that testosterone is one of the first things to go during any sort of energetic insult. And so if you kind of think about just the kind of traditional model when we think about any given mammal, we have this caloric availability coming into the system. This is for any male mammal. And then there's the energetic balance of that individual. And that can then be spent on things like immune function and maintenance. It can be spent on physical activity. It can also be spent on things like testosterone-mediated reproductive effort. And this model works great in a wide variety of mammalian species, everything from primates to carnivores. It's a very useful model. But I think when we think about humans, human life history is really different, and this doesn't necessarily apply as much. Because one of the things about humans is that when human males try to acquire mates, they don't necessarily go out and kill other males. Human system is much more nuanced, and one of the big things that you notice across every subsistence society examined is that males that are more productive are seen as better mates, are seen as more attractive. And part of the reason for that is that a lot of human subsistence strategies involve really physically active production. And so in this case, physical workload can be a form of reproduction. You also don't get the same necessary trade-off between parenting and reproduction in humans because we have a really exceptionally high dependency load. So in most mammalian species, you have a relatively small litter size, and then they leave the home, and then the next litter can be developed. But in humans, you can have four or five dependent offspring all at the same time. We also have an exceptional level of parental investment and a really wide array of intergenerational transfers. And for these reasons, I think we need to think about testosterone not just in terms of male-male competition, but also in terms of physically active production strategies. Well, regardless of which of these models we're thinking about, testosterone is still going to be likely somewhat sensitive to these energetic cues of environmental food availability or immune status. What we find is that in human males, testosterone is actually quite labile, and it's quite reactive to current energetic status. And so if you think about the way in which testosterone is produced, testosterone production begins in the hypothalamus with the production of gonadotropin-releasing hormone. This travels to the pituitary, which releases the luteinizing hormone into the bloodstream, travels down to the testes, which produce testosterone. And then it's a negative feedback cycle. So once testosterone levels get sufficiently high, you downregulate gonadotropin-releasing hormone and luteinizing hormone. So how does this look like when we're thinking about energetic status? Well, if you look at luteinizing hormone production, remember, luteinizing hormone is what stimulates testosterone production in males. If you look at rhesus macaques on a normal day, they get their 30 pellets of Teklad, and then you see a number of spikes throughout the day, especially during the night, of luteinizing hormone. Now, downstream, these are going to all end up being spikes in testosterone as well. Well, when these monkeys, everything's been normal for them, and then you suddenly have a fasted day, you see an immediate decrease in the frequency and amplitude of these pulses of luteinizing hormone, and downstream decreases in testosterone production. Well, once you refeed them, you see an almost immediate return to homeostasis, where very quickly these males begin producing, in fact, larger amounts of luteinizing hormone than normal so that they can get their testosterone back up to normal levels. Well, the same thing holds true in humans. So men who fast for more than 2 days show castrate levels of testosterone. U.S. Army Ranger training during their very physically active week under which they're doing a number of these simulated missions, they oftentimes are burning as many as 6,000 calories a day and taking in less than 1,000. And there have been a couple studies showing that these men have castrate levels of testosterone by the fourth day of training. There have also been some interesting studies where kind of these quasi-experimental studies where one platoon will win something for a day and they'll get a pizza party afterwards. And the next morning, they'll have just very high levels of testosterone compared to normal as their bodies are trying to get back to homeostasis. The same's true for even just undergraduates who miss a single meal. And so some of my work in grad school showed that guys showed about a 10% decrease in testosterone just from missing dinner. And so if you have individuals eat normally for 2 days, and then at the end of the second day, they just skip dinner, so everything else is normal, you see a significant decrease in waking salivary testosterone the next morning. And as soon as they refeed, you see an almost immediate boost in testosterone levels. And so this is really a quite rapid change in testosterone level based on energetic status. And one thing to keep in mind is this is all in energetically buffered young undergraduates in industrial populations. These aren't individuals with exceedingly low body fats. And so if you think about populations where you're experiencing a lot of immunocompromising events, or a reduced energy intake, or an increased energetic expenditure, then these populations, you're likely to experience relatively lower levels of testosterone. And so we would expect to see in most hunter-gatherer, forager, horticultural populations that we would have relatively low levels of testosterone. And that's what we see. So there haven't been too many studies, but this is some work by Peter Ellison, and this top line here is testosterone across the lifespan for U.S. males in Boston. And then here's Congo, Nepal, and then the Aceh. And you can see the Aceh have significantly lower levels of testosterone and apparently a smaller change across the lifespan. But one of the problems here is that we're looking at really small numbers, and you have to worry about things like mortality selection. But essentially, regardless of what population we looked at, it's been noted that there's higher testosterone in industrialized populations and larger declines in those populations in testosterone with age. But like I said, it's really small sample sizes, especially at these older ages. One thing to mention is that this isn't just with males. We actually see the same thing in when we look at female reproductive hormones. And so this graph on top shows a U.S. woman, and you can see post-ovulation, she has a nice spike in progesterone, and that's a nice normal-looking U.S. cycle. Now, beneath that is the cycle of a Bangladeshi woman living in Bangladesh who experienced very high pathogen burden and also much lower food availability. Now, you can see it's obviously order of magnitudes lower, and so this graph was taken to a U.S. obstetrician and asked if this woman, could she ever, become pregnant? And they said, oh, clearly it's not possible for this woman to ever become pregnant. And not only was this actually a normal cycle, it was a conceptive cycle. She had twins. And so we see that in a lot of populations, when you're experiencing these higher parasite and pathogen loads, we're seeing really different levels of testosterone and progesterone and other steroid hormones. So if you look at testosterone in industrialized populations, you see just post-puberty this spike in testosterone, and then kind of a steady decline of about 1 to 3% per year across the rest of the lifespan for U.S. males. The same is true whether you look at cross-sectional data or longitudinal data. It's also been shown in non-U.S. populations, so Japan, Australia, a number of European studies. This has kind of led to the growth of this kind of new cottage industry of low testosterone treatment. And so if you watch a football game or a baseball game, every third commercial is for testosterone treatment. Do you have low T? You should get tested. You know, especially if you have something like fatigue, that's probably testosterone. Trouble sleeping? Really, I mean, any of these things. It could be low testosterone. You should probably get tested right away. And luckily you can, because they have a lot of great internet quizzes that can tell you whether you have low testosterone or not. I mean, you guys think your email's bad? Whew. But there's a growing body of evidence that suggests that in industrial populations, one of the major reasons we see these declines in testosterone with age have to do with obesity. And so one of the things with testosterone is that the male hypothalamus doesn't really differentiate between testosterone and estrogen. There's no need to, because males have very low levels of estrogen. And so throughout evolutionary history, this was never a selective pressure that would have led to any differentiation, the ability to demarcate between these two very, very similar molecules. And one of the things that ends up happening in males is that when testosterone comes into contact with adipose tissue, so fat cells, then aromatization into estrogen can occur. And that estrogen then travels back up to the brain, and instead of the male hypothalamus saying, oh, our testosterone's getting lower, we're getting these higher levels of estrogen, because there's no differentiation, the hypothalamus thinks everything's all fine and sees no reason to increase testosterone. And in males, if you have a relatively higher level of estrogen to testosterone, then it becomes easier to put on abdominal adiposity. And when that happens, you can kind of get into this cycle, and it's kind of just this downward spiral where it becomes easier to put on additional fat mass, and then you can't. It's harder to put on, harder to increase testosterone. But what about populations with lower levels of obesity? So groups like the Chimane, where you have about 8 times lower levels of obesity than U.S. populations, or the Hadza. Well, one thing to also think about is if you're a 50-year-old Chimane father, this gentleman is not 50 years old, but if you are a 50-year-old Chimane, then you're at your peak offspring dependency. And so it's not uncommon to have between 5 and 12 kids at this age. That means that you need to be producing a really large number of calories to feed that family. And so if you're seeing kind of a constant decrease in testosterone with age, and that's preventing you from maintaining your muscle mass, which is then preventing you from engaging in physically active production strategies, that could be a significant problem. So what do we see among the Chimane? Very minimal cross-sectional age-related changes in testosterone. And so this is 460 men, and so it's not likely to be a situation where there's mortality selection. And actually, I now have an N of over 1,200, and we see the same, essentially very little to no change across the lifespan. And I'm currently working on analyzing some longitudinal data 5 years apart to see if we're seeing the same pattern there as well. And if you remember, this is what it looks like in the U.S., where you get this spike and then just a steady decline of about 1% to 3% per year. So one of the things here to think about is I'm kind of talking about this sort of U-shaped distribution, or inverted U-shaped distribution, rather, between body fat and testosterone. So if you're a hunter-gatherer, a forager, horticulturalist, and you have low body fat, and you're experiencing a very high parasite and pathogen load, you have low energy availability, you're unable to maintain these really high levels of testosterone. And then as your body fat gets higher, say like you're a 20-year-old in an industrial population, you still have relatively low body fat, but you're in great condition, and you're able to maintain very high levels of testosterone compared to what would have been normal throughout human history. And then at older ages, once obesity becomes a concern in industrial populations, then you end up seeing relatively low levels of testosterone again. And so the group that I work with are the Chimane, and they're forager horticulturalists in lowland Bolivia, just below the Andes. They largely do subsistence agriculture, slash and burn horticulture, essentially. About 66% of the diet comes from manioc, corn, rice, and plantains. And then about 17% of the diet comes from hunting. The rest comes from fishing, with about 2 to 5% of calories coming from market goods. And so relatively low levels of acculturation. There are about 16,000 Chimane spread across 95 villages of about 30 to 500 adults. And there's a wide range of variability in terms of geographic distribution of these populations. So some are closer to town, and some are more in interior forest communities. The average Chimane woman has a total fertility rate of about 9. And one thing to keep in mind is that the Chimane growth rate is really high. It's about 3.8%. The U.S. during the baby boom, it was about 3.3%. So this is a really rapid growth rate. It's doubling time for the population is about 18 years. So this is really a population in flux. We see across these 95 communities, there's a really really wide range of variation in terms of things like acculturation, market integration, Spanish-speaking ability, access to medical care. No communities have running water. One community had electricity for about 3 months, and then floods wiped that out. The average Chimane man averages about 4.5 hours of physical activity per day and burns about 850 calories more than the average U.S. male. In terms of data that's been collected with the Chimane Health and Life History Project began in 2002. I joined in 2012. And if you think about NHANES, which is the nationally representative U.S. study of biodemography of health in the U.S., they've got about 10,500 specimens. And Chimane Health and Life History now has about 20,000. And so with a lot of really great in-depth longitudinal data. And with this, we can say pretty convincingly that we see very low levels of a lot of risk factors associated with things like heart disease and dementia in the U.S. And so only about 3% of Chimane have high total cholesterol, greater than 200, whereas if you look in the U.S., it's about 30%. Same for low-density lipoproteins. Only about 2% of Chimane have high low-density lipoproteins, whereas about 35% of U.S. Individuals do. This is individuals over the age of 18. See similar stuff for triglycerides, glucose, very, very low levels of diabetes risk. We did have our first case of diabetes, though, this last year. But this is important for a couple of reasons. And one of those is that the target low-density lipoproteins in the U.S. that we're trying to achieve with next-generation statins, as well as ezetimibe and PKSK9 inhibitors, that's 70. And so this is a population that achieves that naturally. And so it's really interesting to study this population, not just because they have a different set of risk factors, but to understand how all of these endocrine systems interact with each other under conditions that we're trying to achieve now. And part of the reason that's important is that cholesterol is used to make all steroid hormones, including things like testosterone. Chimani have a very high parasite and pathogen burden, with about 70% of adults suffering from intestinal parasites at any given time. 59% of those are hookworm. About 50% of the entire population has anemia at any given time. About 30 to 40% have gastrointestinal illness. And about 20 to 30% of adults have respiratory infection at any given time. And very high levels of inflammation, if we look at something like C-reactive protein or sedimentation rate, but very low levels of obesity and essentially no evidence of heart disease. And so with a high level of physical activity and high parasite and pathogen load, as well as reduced food security, it's not really a surprise that Chimani men have about 30% lower levels of testosterone than U.S. men. Now, one of the things to keep in mind is that I don't think it's that Chimani have low testosterone. I think it's that novel environmental circumstances allow U.S. men to achieve these novel levels of testosterone. It's really the Chimani who are normal. It's just us that are weird. But one of the things is that almost all of the work done, say, looking at, you know, associations between testosterone and competition in U.S. males, that's all done right here at peak testosterone levels, young males aged 18 to 22 in college campuses who are experiencing really perhaps evolutionary novel levels of testosterone. And so what does this mismatch mean for thinking about things like behavior, health, or physiology? So that's what we're going to talk about next. So high testosterone isn't always a good thing if you're looking across any mammalian taxa. And one of the ways that it's usually discussed is in terms of the challenge hypothesis. And that's this idea that especially for, it was originally developed in mating bird species, where males can turn off testosterone for a portion of the year while they're engaging in a lot of parenting. And then during the mating season, you see an increase in testosterone. And then if two males come into contact, you see an additional increase in testosterone above and beyond this already relatively high level. And what this is about is keeping the energetics and immunosuppressive effects of testosterone downregulated when you don't need them, and then spiking them only when you need them. Because an acute increase in testosterone during a competitive situation actually makes it easier to pull sugars into the muscle tissue, and you can react faster and stronger. And so these acute changes in testosterone are actually quite beneficial, not to mention the longer-term effects on muscle mass. Well, in humans, it's largely been looked at in terms of, you know, judo competitions, rugby, rowing, soccer, but it also occurs in everything from video games to chess, this acute spike in testosterone during competitive activity. And it's not limited to men. We also see the same thing in women. It's also been looked at from the angle of, in the U.S., married men have lower testosterone, and especially new fathers, you see a relative decrease in testosterone. And in industrialized populations, we don't need to increase our physical activity following like childbirth in order to get additional calories, because most of our jobs require computer screens and desks as opposed to axes or bows. But since we studied most of this that in humans has been studied under with weird undergrads, we see the same effects in populations like the Chimani. And so I've done a couple studies looking at this. And the first one, we set up a soccer tournament where we brought together 8 different communities that wouldn't normally interact with each other, and brought them together and held a big soccer tournament. Took saliva specimens before and after. And from immediately before the game to 10 minutes after the game, we see about a 30% increase in testosterone. In the U.S., the confidence interval on percent change in testosterone following some kind of a sports competitive activity averages from between 13 to 60%, and the average change is about 37%. So despite low baseline testosterone, Chimani are experiencing essentially the same percent increase, the same relative increase in testosterone. And it isn't just kind of contrived competitive events, although soccer is a culturally important activity for the Chimane. Most communities have an old field that they've cleared out and play soccer on. So it's not kind of a novel exercise for them. But we've also looked at acute changes in testosterone during horticultural productivity, where you see about a 50% increase in testosterone as guys are chopping trees. You see similar increases while hunting. And we've also done some work looking at just changes in testosterone while guys are taking shots on goal. And while you see lower changes in testosterone when taking shots on goals, it's still a significant increase. So testosterone certainly can affect behavior. And despite these low levels of testosterone, we're still seeing similar hormone behavior interactions. But what does this mean for physiology? So let's talk about androgens and prostate size. So the prostate is the male exocrine gland that produces about 25 to 30% of the seminal fluid. And prostate growth, especially benign prostatic hyperplasia, which is not prostate cancer, but just enlarged prostates, is considered an inevitable part of male aging. And it's estimated that around 90% of men that live to the age of 80 will experience prostatic hyperplasia. And so this is just graphs from other populations showing that by the time you reach 80, the majority of men in the industrialized populations have benign prostatic hyperplasia. One of the things to keep in mind is that while it's not prostate cancer, this is still a quite damaging condition. About 40% of U.S. males will have to seek treatment in their lifetime for it, and in many cases that involves surgery. It's also a really great example of antagonistic pleiotropy. So higher levels of testosterone, whether they're endogenous testosterone produced by yourself or exogenous, as in injected, or from a patch, those are associated with larger prostate sizes. So benign prostatic hyperplasia is not an issue in populations of eunuchs. And also the main pharmacological treatment for treating benign prostatic hyperplasia is testosterone inhibitors. But higher androgens also correlate with reproductive effort, and especially at younger ages. Men that go through earlier puberty have larger prostate size early and are able to get reproductive systems online faster, and they're at a higher risk of benign prostatic hyperplasia later in life. So these rapid increases in prostate size during puberty can yield some early fitness benefits, but in terms of the growth of prostates, it's never an issue until very late in life, in the 60s or the 70s, and that's already in selection shadow when most men are already done with their reproductive careers. While more than 7 million men in the U.S. alone suffer from benign prostatic hyperplasia, the etiology is still not well characterized. We know that age, androgens, and obesity all play contributing factors, but despite the fact that so many men experience this, it's really not well characterized. But we'd think that a group like the Chimane, with lower levels of androgens and very low levels of obesity and metabolic syndrome, might experience lower levels of benign prostatic hyperplasia. So to find out, I did abdominal ultrasounds on, well, I didn't do them, our doctor did, on 350 Chimane men aged 40 to 80. Traditionally in the U.S., you think about like digital rectal exam or the gold standard is transrectal ultrasound, but those tend to be fairly invasive and would not have been appropriate in this population, but they're highly correlated with abdominal ultrasounds. And in the lab, we did a fasting morning blood draw, and I measured testosterone, prostate-specific antigen, which is an antigen that's produced by the prostate, sex hormone-binding globulin, and then point-of-care glycosylated hemoglobin. Glycosylated hemoglobin is a measure of total glucose exposure over a long period of time. And one of the nice things about it is that it's an integrated measure that you don't have to worry about if someone ate something weird last night or if they had something before the test, although all these individuals were fasting. So if we look at prostate volume by age in a number of populations from UK, German, Dutch, from the US, we see this pretty steady increase in prostate size with age. And one thing to keep in mind is that the anatomical cutoff for benign prostatic hyperplasia is 20 cubic centimeters. And so most of these men, by the time they reach age 45, are, on average, already experiencing the very early stages of benign prosthetic hyperplasia. You experience much worse outcomes around 40 cubic centimeters. The Chimane have very low levels of benign prosthetic hyperplasia and relatively small prostate sizes. Also a smaller rate of change with age. And even if you were to say, if you're thinking about the average Chimane, they're about 10% shorter than the average US male. And most organs kind of scale to height. So as kind of a conservative measure, if we were to increase Chimane prostate sizes by 10%, we actually still see that very low levels of benign prosthetic hyperplasia across the lifespan for Chimane. And so compared to industrialized populations, the average Chimane prostate is about 13 cubic centimeters smaller. And that's about the size of one of those Keurig cups, those K-cups for coffee. That doesn't seem very large, but if that's something that's compressing your urethra, that's kind of a big deal. We also see a shallower rate of change with age. And if we look at age-standardized rates of benign prosthetic hyperplasia, for the Chimane, about 28% achieve benign prosthetic hyperplasia, where in the U.S. it's about 60%. The average Chimane prostate is about 62% smaller than the average U.S. prostate. And one thing that's also important is that advanced cases of benign prosthetic hyperplasia, larger than 40 cubic centimeters, this is where men start to really have big problems with going to the bathroom multiple times per night or frequent or incomplete urination. Those were almost non-existent in this population. Less than 1% of Chimane had prostates this size, whereas about 50% of U.S. males in their 70s have prostates greater than 40 cubic centimeters. So if you think about the size of a Chimane prostate versus a U.S. prostate for a man in his 70s, a U.S. prostate is about the size of an egg, where a Chimane prostate is just the size of the yolk of that egg. So this is a significant difference. But despite the fact that Chimane have low levels of testosterone, we found a trend towards larger prostate volumes for men with higher levels of testosterone. And for men who are in the two highest quintiles of testosterone, they had about a 2.5 times increased risk of benign prosthetic hyperplasia. And this is despite levels of testosterone 30% lower than men in the U.S. And so, kind of as you'd expect, since the prostate produces prostate-specific antigen, there was a strong correlation between prostate-specific antigen and prostate size. And men who were above the U.S. cutoff for prostate-specific antigen were about 10 times the risk of benign prosthetic hyperplasia. And also, so no Chimane has ever had glycosylated hemoglobin, HbA1c, greater than the 7%, which is indicative of diabetes. And so despite subclinical levels of glycosylated hemoglobin, we actually did see a positive association between glycosylated hemoglobin and prostate size. So even with low glucose exposure, glucose is still a risk. Each about 1% increase in glycosylated hemoglobin was equivalent to about 17 years of prostate growth. Now, one of the limitations here is that we can't differentiate between, through ultrasound, you can't differentiate between benign prosthetic hyperplasia or other prostate conditions like prostate cancer. And so it could be that one or two of the larger prostates we saw were actually prostate cancer. But if anything, that only strengthens our results because we're talking here about benign prosthetic hyperplasia, not prostate cancer. So despite these low risk factors, we still see positive associations between glucose uptake and testosterone. And that's especially important if we're thinking about this age of low testosterone therapies, where there are a large number of men. In fact, it's increased fourfold in the last decade that are seeking these testosterone supplementations. So those men, even if they're given low-dose exogenous testosterone, might be putting themselves at a real increased risk of prostate growth. And so if you think about the inevitability of benign prosthetic hyperplasia, it may not be inevitable, especially in populations that don't have the same level of energetic availability and these lower levels of testosterone. It's also a great classic example of antagonistic pleiotropy, where high testosterone and rapid prostate growth is advantageous at younger ages, but at older ages can be really deleterious. So if having this lower level of testosterone could be somewhat protective, why has there been this real growth in testosterone and supplementation in the last decade? Well, there are a number of studies that have shown that in the U.S. and other industrialized populations, men with low testosterone are at higher risks of all-cause mortality, cardiovascular morbidity, depression, cognitive function, and Alzheimer's and dementia. And so the medical establishment has been really kind of focused on just the treatment of low testosterone. But really, low testosterone is just the canary in the mine. If you have heart disease, or if you have obesity, or a number of cancers, then that can cause lower levels of testosterone. And so we really need to be focused on what's causing this trade-off in these men's condition, what's causing this decrease in testosterone. We shouldn't really be treating testosterone itself. But this has kind of been a continual problem of just treating the symptoms and not the actual root cause. It's happened in a number of different populations, not just men. So if you go to the National Institutes of Health website, they link five of their main areas of ways to prevent aging are all hormones. This has also been done in women already. Estrogen hormone replacement therapy was huge for a long period of time, from the 1980s up until around 2001. And so if you look at the number of women using hormone replacement therapy, they had a fourfold increase in the number of hormone replacement therapy users between 1985 and 2001, or 2002 rather, when the Women's Health Initiative came out showing that actually these women were at a greater increased risk of endometrial and breast cancers. In fact, there's a study just this last week in Lancet showing that even women who had hormone therapy for less than 5 years were at about almost a 1.5 times relative risk of getting ovarian cancer. But kind of thinking beyond just the prostate, there are a lot of other consequences of testosterone supplementation. If you're taking a testosterone supplement, then your testes aren't producing that testosterone, and so testicular atrophy is a common problem. These individuals are at increased risk for MI, cardiovascular morbidity, and thrombosis. It also could have important immune implications. Testosterone is decreasing during illness for a reason, so that you can invest those scarce energetic resources towards immune function. But really, if we think about testosterone, it's just the canary in the mine. It's a symptom of kind of poor overall condition. And so it makes sense that men who are in poor condition in the U.S. are at a greater risk of mortality, cardiovascular morbidity, depression, cognitive dysfunction, or Alzheimer's. But what about a population that starts off with relatively low levels of testosterone, like the Chimane? Well, got some work showing that Chimane men with higher levels of testosterone have better cognitive function, better short-term memory, long-term memory, and a visual scanning task. We also have some work right now looking at testosterone and depression in Chimane men, and men who have higher levels of testosterone show lower levels of depression. But there might actually be reasons to think about to think that we would see actually worse outcomes in the U.S. than among the Chimane. And one of the reasons for that is that in the Chimane, they have relatively low levels of testosterone, but it's across the lifespan. In the U.S., we have these high levels of testosterone during and following puberty. And one of the things is, that's when we lay down all of our testosterone receptors. So testosterone receptors in bone, in brain, in the heart, muscle tissue. And so if you are laying down all these receptors during a time when you have really high testosterone, like U.S. males in early puberty, then at older ages, if you're seeing a decline of about 1% to 3% per year, you're going to have a real mismatch between receptor densities and circulating testosterone levels. And that might not actually be the case for a group like the Chimane, where they have relatively low levels of testosterone, but then a smaller or no real change with age in terms of testosterone levels across the lifespan. And so one of the things that I'm working on now is measuring peripheral androgen receptors for young men in the U.S. and old men in the U.S., and also for young and old Chimane men. So we talked about some trade-offs under kind of relatively homeostatic normal conditions. But now let's talk about some of those trade-offs during significant natural disaster. So during the dry season, the Manihiki River is about 10 meters across, and you can walk across it. It's about waist height in most areas. But in February of 2014, there was a 100-year flood, partially caused by just extreme levels of rain that were really relatively unheard of, and possibly potentially also because of a whole set of hydroelectric dams on the Brazilian border that had just come online. Bolivia is currently suing Brazil over those hydroelectric dams and cite them as the cause of this flood. So this is the Manique River, February 24th, 2014. And so it was around 10 kilometers wide at that point. If you look at, this is kind of the edge of the Chimane territory near the Beni River. And so here's March 28, 2013, and February 17th, 2014. There was a massive increase in flooding during this time period. In terms of kind of the impact in Bolivia in general, about 60 to 80,000 Bolivian nationals were displaced across the Beni department, which is sort of like the state. So the state of Beni, about a quarter of the population were displaced. Around 250,000 head of cattle were lost. But for a population like the Chimane, with really low integration into Bolivian society and also into social security networks, the Chimane were especially impacted. Although one thing that's kind of interesting is that cattle ranchers can't go back to foraging, but Chimane can, especially middle-aged and older Chimane. Younger Chimane men don't necessarily have that same option because they oftentimes aren't very good hunters yet, or perhaps they grew up in areas without really any good hunting territory anymore. So the impact on the Chimane was pretty devastating. All communities along the river were flooded, and it ended up being about, I think, around 80% of all communities were flooded. The data I'm going to show in a minute are all from Chimane communities along the river that we've since done a series of interviews with. And so among those that were along the river, 95% of those families reported water in their homes, and around 75% of them reported they had to evacuate their homes. Nearly every family we've interviewed reported some level of crop loss. So during the flood itself, we focused on evacuations and donations. We raised a really large amount of money. We also worked with the Bolivian government, giving them GPS locations for communities so they could drop, they could do helicopter drops. But after the flood and after the water started to come down, we really started thinking that lots of people have studied shocks to systems and how individuals deal with it. In fact, we have a yearly interview where we ask people about crop losses and how they dealt with those crop losses. But it really hasn't been studied when the entire system collapses, because if you normally go to your brother when you have some small crop loss, but if your brother had a massive crop loss as well, then this can become a real significant problem. And so we had kind of four main things that we were working on when we wrote this grant. And I have to say, NSF Rapid is a really interesting funding mechanism. I wrote it in 3 days, and we sent it off, and 2 weeks later, we were funded. And so they're made to be a very, very rapid response. The first Rapid grant was actually during Hurricane Katrina, and a group wanted to measure the level of water on the walls in houses as they were about to be torn down. But we wanted to examine the effects of disaster on health, psychosocial stress, and physical activity levels. We also wanted to examine how pre-flood health, wealth, and human capital and those social networks influenced these changes post-flood. So is it that people who had large social networks and were in really good condition beforehand, did they weather this better than those who weren't? Or did that matter? We also wanted to test individual level factors, things like personality or community residence, and see how those moderate the effect of the flood on these individuals and their recovery. And also to kind of see, is this going to be a situation that just causes leveling? Because we were starting to get higher Gini coefficients, levels of inequality in some of the communities near town, where some of the young men were doing wage labor and starting to buy material goods, whereas some other communities further out, there really wasn't any inequality yet. And so does this cause a leveling of that inequality, or is it just going to enhance it? So those are kind of the goals of this project. And one thing to say is that all of our work right now is still preliminary, and we're still collecting data. And so under natural disaster, there's been a lot of previous work examining trade-offs under these small-scale shocks or normal conditions. And we've done a lot of work looking at localized shocks among the Chimani as well. But with 99% of the Chimani affected reporting crop loss, these normal sharing and buffering strategies tend to collapse, especially when most of your sharing partners are in the same community urine. And so if your community was infected, it's about 95% of individuals in those communities were affected. And so as the water was starting to go back down, we started doing collecting anthropometric data and data on reported illnesses. And we also did medical exams of all pregnant Chimani women in order to create a kind of a cohort study of in utero exposures. We did inventories of crop losses, collected data on food sharing and money sharing. We did a depression inventory, a time discounting experiment, and collected saliva samples to examine biomarkers related to immune function and stress. And so the preliminary data I'm going to talk about today, it's 430 families. The average number of offspring in these families was 8, so it's a fairly large sample. And these were all collected between March 18th and May 21st. So this is all almost immediately following the flood. The water peaked on February 17th. So one thing that's kind of interesting is that there are several nearby populations, one of them being the Mozaten, that speak actually the same language family. It's a language isolate. It's just just the Chimani and Mozaten. It's essentially the same language. And they live in the same environment, but the Mozaten tend to build these raised houses. So we asked Chimani if they were going to change this, and essentially no one indicated that they want to change their housing structure based on the flood. However, about 70% reported that they plan to move their house to higher ground. Most of these individuals said they didn't want to move to another community. I think that was like 4 to 8% or so said they wanted to move to another community, but people wanted to move within their community to higher ground. And especially those families that reported illness, so individuals that reported illness in their family during this flood period were about twice as likely to move their homes. So in terms of debt in this population, most of the debt is concentrated in younger families because older families haven't really entered into any of the market system. But among younger families, we see about 24% of the population have some level of debt prior to the flood. And those younger families were more likely to ask or borrow for money during the flood itself. We saw a wider breadth of food sharing during the flood than usual. And we also saw an association between the amount of crops you lost and the probability that you engaged in food sharing in either direction. And so one terai is about a tenth of an acre. And so for each tenth of an acre increase in crop loss, there was about a 4% increase in the probability that you engaged in some level of food sharing. We also saw a wider breadth of food sharing than usual. So in an average two-day period in 2013, 64% of individuals reported sharing food, and usually with sons and daughters, grandchildren, niece, nephews, brothers, parents-in-law. But during the flood itself, we saw about 89% of individuals saying they engaged in some level of food sharing, and with a wider array of people than we normally see people sharing with. And so one of the next steps for this is we're going to do more formal network analyses looking at who individuals were sharing with and if you were reaching out to much further ties than normal during the flood because of how bad the situation was. Our depression inventory, we found that we saw an increase in nervous mentality, especially for women and families that lost more crops or that had illness. Interestingly, for men, the amount of crop loss didn't impact their reports of nervousness, but having illness in their family did. We see higher levels of reports of sadness than usual, and illness but not crop loss predicted changes in sleeping pattern for men and women, controlling for age. We saw higher levels of depression than normal, and when we asked people if they felt do you feel an increased interest in working? Or do you feel the same way about working? Or do you feel less interest in working? What we found was about half the population reported less interest in work than normal. But about 20% of the population reported that they were more animated to work than normal. And so now we're looking at kind of personality as a mediator of these trade-offs between those individuals that saw this as a major shock and then didn't feel like working more and those that did feel like working more. One of the things that we found was that you were significantly less likely to say you were going to move your house or that you're going to move your community, or that you're going to move your field, if you had prior flood experience. So if you lived in an area that, if you'd been previously flooded, then you were less likely to move. And this is largely because most of those individuals actually already moved their homes when they previously were flooded. In terms of kind of from a biomedical context, so we have about 300 individuals that we saw in the 6 months prior to the flood and the 6 months after the flood. And we see a decrease of about one unit of BMI in that time range. We also see lower levels of hemoglobin and higher white blood cell counts. And so a one unit decrease in BMI is really pretty big. So in kinds of, in terms of the clinical relevance of that, post-flood, you're about 2.6 times more likely to be anemic. And post-flood, you're also about 2.4 times more likely to have high white blood cell count. And so we kind of took this as evidence that sharing networks were sufficiently shocked to the point where they couldn't fully buffer the population anymore. We did a hypothetical time discounting experiment. And individuals with greater levels of crop losses were more likely to be present-oriented following the flood. This also might end up being a catalyst for lifestyle change. So before the flood, about 10% of men reported doing some wage labor. These are from the previous year's interviews. Following the flood, about 30% of men noted that they tended to do some wage labor following the flood. And those individuals that had higher crop losses had a higher likelihood of engaging in wage labor. It was about a 4% increase in the probability of saying you were going to engage wage labor per tenth of an acre lost. But this is kind of interesting in perspective because the Chimani really are a population in flux. And so we think that this might end up being a catalyst in moving especially a lot of the younger men towards wage labor. But it's going to be interesting in the following years to see how cultural changes, things like loss of language, integration into Bolivian society, how those impact health and physiology. There was one community that had electricity, and soon more will. And one of the things is most Chimani communities are pretty spread out. It can take an hour or two to walk across most communities. But in order to get electricity, people have to move in close next to each other. One thing, too, is that Chimani also experience really high levels of discrimination. And so they're seen as kind of like second or third class citizens. And so as they engage more into wage labor and market economies, that they're going to experience increased discrimination. It'll be interesting to see in the coming decades whether changes in diet and physical activity lead the Chimani more towards the Native American populations in terms of diabetes and obesity, or if there's another option. So the Chimani, I think, are really important to teach us about health. We can see the epidemiological transition in action. We're already seeing declining infant mortality, and some of the communities near town already have lower fertility. But this isn't important just in terms of thinking about the past, but you know, almost 50% of the world population right now is rural. The global burden of things like diabetes and cardiovascular disease are increasing, and it's really critical to understand the etiology of these disease processes, especially for countries that are facing the dual burden, where they have high parasites and pathogens and also obesity. So obviously, you know, no single population represents the mosaic of populations in which humans evolved. But I think that working with subsistence populations like the Chimani is really important. And it's more than just examining differences in risk factor, but it's understanding how endocrine systems interact with one another under a different set of environmental conditions. And I think that really taking an evolutionary approach to global health problems is going to be important for the future. So we talked today about some observational and experimental studies looking at health and physiology under different sets of environmental conditions. But one of the things that I always try and bring home is that hormones aren't just proximate mechanisms. They aren't just some outcome variable. They're actually really theoretically interesting links between condition and behavior. Thank you. Dan?
So I have a purple question on the fasting testosterone relationship. Mm-hmm. And that's whether the rebound that you see on refeeding is such that the average level is the same, lower or higher than you would see if there was no fasting. So
yeah.
Looking at your eyeballing, it looked like the average level across multiple days would still be lower if you count the fasting drop But I wonder whether, have you done the analysis, do you know the answer to the question?
So one of the things that's interesting about testosterone is that it has this really strong circadian rhythm. So peaks around like 6 a.m. or so, or 5 a.m., and then you see these pretty steady declines across the day. And so what I looked at in these individuals, what it looks like to me is that if you're fasting, then you have this kind of lower baseline level for the day. And then as soon as you refeed, you spike up to where you would have been a couple hours prior to that. And so I think it's more of a shift of the circadian rhythm and shifting the time of day. You see something sort of similar looking at the macaques, where normally with these macaques, you wouldn't see as many of these spikes, especially in this early portion of the day. And so I think it's kind of shifting some of the circadian rhythm to try and get back to homeostasis.
Yeah, so I'm asking, I guess, if you wanted to calculate total exposure, say lifetime exposure or something like that, right? If you had intermittent periods of fasting and rebound, so just eyeballing that, right, it looks like if you average fasted and refeeding together, you end up at about the same level as the normal feed day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I think one of the things that's important there is that we modify our kind of like what we consider our like homeostatic baseline by what our conditions are. So there's been some really cool work coming out of Bangladesh looking at migrants to the UK. And what they find is that for female migrants who migrate to the UK prior to puberty, those individuals end up with normal high levels of progesterone, just like women in the UK. Those that migrate later, post-puberty, they end up with relatively low levels of progesterone across the lifespan. And I don't know for sure, but they've been doing some work with testosterone on that as well. And my guess is that there's some kind of a set point, probably around puberty. And so groups like the Chimane, even if we change their energetic conditions now, they wouldn't have the same like area under the curve total exposure if we change their conditions post-puberty. If we change them pre-puberty, then we might see similar levels of overall testosterone exposure.
Yeah, so that's an intriguing point, which is the kind of window for the calibration of the system. But it's a separate one than the one that I was trying to pursue, really, which is you didn't really frame these periods of caloric restriction in ancestral terms, but one could easily incorporate that to just like parasite loads and all the rest of it, right? The duration of caloric expenditure on the across the lifespan. I mean, presumably there was enormous variation across ecologies, but a typical ancestral human, you know, probably not infrequently would have encountered at least short periods of fasting and probably episodic food shortages as mm-hmm. well, right? So you might expect that the system is really designed for that, and there are a number of possible designs. One is, you know, you overcompensate or you compensate, so you try and get back to high testosterone levels once caloric availability allows for it, right? Another possibility is that the system is really just in kind of stasis when there's shortage and goes back to where it was. So if you stretch this graph out, right, for days, weeks, and keep repeating, you wouldn't necessarily see a net gain. And it's hard to tell from these data which of those answers is correct.
I think that's a really interesting question, and I think that we really need to do more research into that. One of the things that was interesting about this was I just asked guys to skip a single meal, and I had probably around 10% of the guys in the sample wrote notes saying that they had terrible dreams or that this was really unpleasant and how much they hated it, and this is just a single meal. I mean, that's really a normal thing for most people around the world, and especially in most populations prior to industrialization. And so I think that that's a really great and interesting question. I'd really like to look at levels of, especially ghrelin and adiponectin and leptin in a group like the Chimane under situations in which they're eating and which they're not eating, and see if we see real variation in fasting. So one of the things I didn't say was that I actually was measuring ghrelin in these guys as well. And ghrelin it's considered the hunger hormone. So it's produced by the stomach and islet cells in the pancreas. And if I injected myself with ghrelin right now, then I would report feeling very hungry. And about 20 minutes post-eating, which is about as much time as it takes for the signal of energetic homeostasis to make it to the hypothalamus and then back down, you see decreases in ghrelin production. And so one of the interesting things is, so as you'd expect, you see the highest number of receptors in the body for ghrelin in the hypothalamus. You also see a number in the stomach and then the islet cells of the pancreas. The other area that really lights up are the testes. And so if they've done some cool studies in rats where they take rat testes and they put them in a petri dish, and if you normally if you put luteinizing hormone in that dish, they'll produce a bunch of testosterone. And so I don't do these studies. People do. But they normally produce a lot of testosterone. But if you take them and you expose them to ghrelin first, and then you expose them to luteinizing hormone, it doesn't matter how much luteinizing hormone, they won't produce any testosterone. And so it means that it suggests to me that the system is designed to not only downregulate at the level of the hypothalamus, but to downregulate rapidly, even in the testes. So I think there's a lot of really cool work there to be done with hunger. And it's really just completely understudied in U.S.
Yeah, just a source that you may not have tapped already is the Minnesota semi-starvation experiment, where I'm pretty sure that they report pretty dramatic libido declines fairly quickly into the starvation process.
That would make sense. Yeah, I haven't looked into that. I'll definitely do that, though.
Yeah, I was curious about the relationship between testosterone and cognition and mental health. So it sounds like the levels of testosterone that people in here are experiencing are more or less outside the ancestral range, except, you know, maybe someone who was really good, had really good access to food, low parasite load, and so on, might have had something approximating what we would, many of us, experience during our teenage years, right? I guess what I'm wondering is, you know, is there, and this is just asking you to speculate, unless there's data on this, I mean, you could imagine that systems in the brain for deciding how well you're doing are going to be using testosterone as a signal, or maybe just as a correlate of some kind. You know, it sounds like everyone in contemporary Western weird societies is walking around getting a signal that everything's fantastic all the time. Are there public health consequences of that? I mean, is there any? It just is interesting to think.
Yeah. So depression is really interesting because in the U.S. we kind of get this, a lot of studies find an effect where you see a kind of a spike, a midlife crisis spike in levels of depression. Not everyone finds that, but a lot of studies find that. With the Chimane, we have a couple thousand data points and a lot of really good longitudinal data on this showing that it actually just increases throughout the lifespan. And so as you get older and you start to, senescence kicks in and you can't chop as many trees, you can't hunt as well anymore, you basically continually get less and less happy with life. And so I think that for a group like the Chimane and under the conditions under which this whole system developed, it's going to be something like that, where, you know, when you start to have, at older ages, we get a lot of food insecurity. A lot of older Chimane have trouble feeding themselves because they can't chop as big of a field. And food insecurity is, like, I think the number one predictor of depression among the Chimane. And so I think that as you're getting these declines in physical ability, that those are going to be tied to changes in things like depression. And so one of the things with depression that's interesting is with testosterone supplementation, there are a couple areas where people tout it as something like being really beneficial. One of those is like bone mass density. One of those is fat mass. And another of those is like kind of muscle tissue. And the final one is depression and then cognition. And so there have been a number of studies that have tried different things to change cognitive performance using testosterone supplementation and haven't found any effects yet. With bone mass density, they've actually shown really definitively that, yes, testosterone supplementation does increase bone mass, but it's not actually testosterone, it's estrogen. So when you give somebody a really high dose of testosterone, a lot of that aromatizes into estrogen, and it's actually the estrogenic effects that are important. And if you give a guy a high dose of testosterone and something that blocks the aromatization of testosterone to estrogen, he has no change in bone mass density. So it's definitely the estrogen side is what's changing bone mass. But the one area where they do see significant effects are depression. And so older guys who are depressed and they get some like moderate dose testosterone, you start to see decreases in depression. So I think some of that's going to be psychoactive, and some of that's probably going to be that they're able to better maintain their muscle mass. And so they're, you know, if you're feeling better, then you're going to feel better, I think.
Can I ask just to follow up on that? So, I mean, one of the things I was thinking about is if you think about sort of motivational systems, I would guess, I know that testosterone itself has some effect on competitiveness, or I don't know what the causal relationship there is, but it sounds like if you have this signal that everything's great, I'm getting enough food, I have low parasites, and so on, the effect that would have on motivation would be, would do everything that you're currently doing because it's working out great, right? You wouldn't, I would guess that would basically be a signal to not try to change your situation. And I guess what I'm wondering in a very speculative way, if you grow up and you're eating McDonald's and such, and you have good relatively low parasite loads, if that would have some effect on people's motivational system, basically, where
I would bet that it does. And I think this could be another one of those cases where it would also be the receptor density changes. So normally when we think about hormones, we just think about hormones. But I think that the future is going to be in thinking about multiple integrated systems, but especially with receptors. And so if you're young and everything's going great, and there's no reason to change the system because you're doing great, keep it up. You get these high levels of high receptor density to match your high testosterone. And then later in life, that could have some really big consequences. So the only thing I can think of that's done something similar were economic games in men and women. And so there have been a number of studies done where they take young men or old men and they give them some testosterone supplementation. And then before and after economic games, you see some changes, like more likely to reject in ultimatum games, things like that. And there are probably four or five studies that have done this, looking at exogenous testosterone. And they all find an effect. In women, there's a really great study in 2009 in PNAS, and using more women than men in these previous studies, and they found no effect whatsoever of testosterone on behavior. And I think that the reason for that is that women have about 18 and a half times lower levels of testosterone, and so during puberty, they didn't lay down receptors for testosterone because that wasn't important. So it wouldn't matter how much testosterone is added to the system for them. If they don't have the receptors for it, you're not going to get a change in behavior.
You measured a bunch of different hormones. Did you also measure cortisol?
Mm-hmm.
And could you talk a little bit about the kind of interactions or interplay between cortisol and testosterone?
Yeah. So let me talk about this real quick then. There's been some great work by Sapolsky and people in this room showing that high levels of cortisol for a long period of time downregulate gonadosteroids. And so they downregulate testosterone production. And that's all baseline testosterone. I think that actually when you see increases in testosterone during some kind of competitive activity, you also see a lot of concurrent increases in cortisol.
Right.
And so now I think that there are a couple ways that that could happen. I think that one of the areas that's untapped that I think is going to be the future of it is looking at testosterone in terms of the way we measure it. So usually for these studies, when we measure testosterone, say when I measured before and after a soccer game, then I was just measuring salivary testosterone. And so it's just the amount of testosterone that's free and not bound to any binding globulins. But if you look at the actual amount of circulating testosterone in my blood right now, 98% of it is bound to a carrier protein. And so about half of it's bound to albumin, which is a relatively weak bond, and about half of it's bound to sex hormone binding globulin, which is a relatively strong bond and pretty hard to dissociate. So when we measure a change in testosterone following, say, a soccer match, then we see, if normally up here, the amount of testosterone that we measure before the game, I have this 2%. If I see a doubling in the amount of testosterone in my system following the game, I don't actually know whether that was an increase in the amount of total circulating testosterone, an increase in the amount of just the free testosterone that's unbound, or a change in the ratio of free to bound testosterone. And so one of the things that's really interesting is that humans have these really high levels of testosterone that are bound. So if you look at most avian models, most bird species, it's around 13% of their testosterone is bound. And that which is bound is really weakly bound to a cortisol-binding globulin. So the time frame of these changes is also interesting. Because if I injected myself with luteinizing hormone right now, like a real big dose, it would take about, and that's the what stimulates testosterone production, it's about 45 to 75 minutes before I'd see a significant increase in circulating testosterone as produced by my gonads. But in men and women, you see these changes in as little as 5 to 15 minutes. And so there's something else going on here. Now, part of it could be small amounts of testosterone and dihydrotestosterone can be released by the adrenal glands. But one of the things that I think is really interesting is that epinephrine, which is one of the few things that can increase in, you know, 5-minute periods, adrenaline, it binds to albumin with, I think, a higher affinity than testosterone. And so I've been doing some stimulation studies in our lab where I take a sample of whole blood. I've only done it for 4 people, so these aren't, like, take them with a grain of salt. But I took these samples of whole blood, and then I added a small amount of epinephrine to them. And so I had one sample that I didn't add anything to, and one sample that I did add stuff to. And then I put them in an incubator for 15 minutes, and then I measured the testosterone in those samples. And the samples that had epinephrine, and so, the sample that didn't get anything actually got the vehicle, which was just RPMI. It was just what it was in. But the samples that got epinephrine, increase in testosterone by 22 to 29% across these 4 samples. So it's just 4. But I think that that could be a really interesting reason. Because normally when we think about cortisol, we think of it as being something bad that downregulates testosterone. But that's all for baseline levels. I think that on the acute level, you want that boost of cortisol as well, because that has a lot of important effects for pulling sugars into tissues as well.
So when you measure testosterone in saliva, you're only measuring a tiny percentage.
Yeah, so one of the things is that the testosterone that can make it into saliva that crosses those cell membranes, mm-hmm. Only testosterone that's free could make it across, because anything that's bound to like a massive binding protein like albumin, that can't make it across those cell membranes. Mm-hmm. But, tiny, tiny steroids can.
Seems like what's one thing that's ideologically important here is the relative change in what testosterone level is. So throughout our entire lives, pretty much we have higher testosterone than the Chimani, except at the tail end maybe. So I'm then curious why we have the decline that we have. You sort of attribute this, I believe, to obesity, but I wonder, has that been demonstrated? For example, if you were controlling for BMI, is it the case that in the U.S. population that you see less of a decline, or is it flatter, more like the Chimani, or?
Yeah, so that's a great question. And what's been done so far is when they've looked at like longitudinal changes in testosterone in men across like a 10-year period, what you see is the guys that have increased BMIs, or especially increased body fat, those guys have a larger decrease in testosterone. And there's also been some cool stuff looking at bariatric surgery, where they take guys pre-bariatric surgery and post-bariatric surgery, and after they're all healed up post-bariatric surgery, they see much higher levels of testosterone than pre-bariatric surgery. Now, I think that it's not just the obesity. There's also going to be some other factor from things like heart disease that are increasing inflammation in your body. All of these like inflammatory effects, those cost energy. And so despite the fact that we're pretty buffered, my guess is that some of the decrease is going to be because of condition. If you're more likely to get sick, if you're, you have more bouts of flu because you're older and you're in poorer condition, then you're going to be able to maintain testosterone at a slightly lower level. I think that one of the things is that the Chimani, because they experience that all the time, they just stay at this kind of baseline level. And then because they're experiencing pretty constant levels of inflammation across the lifespan.
So it seems like, based on your results, in response to this catastrophic event, Chimani, where some folks were willing to shift certain strategies but not others. So you mentioned, increased willingness to do contract work, paid labor. And you also said that almost nobody was willing to change, the style of the houses they were living in. So I was wondering, what you think, that willingness to shift sort of these economic aspects, but not say these habitation aspects, is related to, and if Chimani folks told you why that was the case, that they wouldn't be willing to do X, change the style of house or whatever it is.
Yeah, so when I asked about changing the style of house and showed a picture of a Moza 10 house, what I was told was, we don't know how to build like that. I think that one of the big things in terms of like the increasing wage labor is that there's going to be a real switch in terms of age. I don't want to say this with like too much certainty yet, but for the most part, it takes a long time to become a really good hunter. And you're getting peak return rates in your 40s or so. And a lot of the younger guys have grown up in areas with depleted animal populations because they got this really high growth rate, 18-year doubling time. So because of that, these younger guys are growing up in an area where there are less animals, and so they're engaging in less hunting, and they're not as great at hunters. And then, you know, maybe this is their first or second year chopping their fields by themselves, and so they still aren't that great at chopping down the trees because there's a real art to it. You can have guys that'll take down one tree and have it knock over seven trees in like a domino effect. And so it's something that takes a lot of time to become really proficient at. And so my guess is that a lot of the younger guys who couldn't revert to hunting and foraging because they weren't that good at it and they weren't used to it, and then also the fact that they were already seeing relatively low returns from their fields, for them it was an easier switch point because they said, oh, I can't go do this, therefore I'm going to go into town. And a lot of the younger generation, a lot of guys now speak Spanish. And so because they could speak Spanish, they could enter into a wage economy and make that shift, whereas older individuals in the population, because they could revert to hunting and because they don't have very much Spanish, then it's much harder for them to, you know, come into town. One of the things also that was really unfortunate was that because there were all these young men and people in general coming into town looking for wage jobs, it really kind of it increased the supply, and the demand was relatively constant. And so you saw a decrease in the price that these guys were getting per day of wage labor. So because you have all these people coming in. And then one of the things on top of that was that the market town of San Borja, it was essentially an island for about 3 months. And so food prices skyrocketed. So these guys are getting paid less than they should for a day's work, and they can't buy as much. And so kind of got this situation where a lot of the younger guys got trapped and had to work and had to keep working. And so this last, like between May and June, that's the time when you want to chop your field for the next year, because that's when it's the driest. And then like at the end of June and July, then you can burn it. And that's the way that you do your fields. You can't wait until September and then chop, because then you hit the rainy season at the wrong time and you can never burn. And so a lot of these young guys got trapped in town, essentially, because they had to keep hand-to-mouth feeding their families. And so they weren't able to come back and chop their trees. And so now they're basically stuck in a cycle of wage labor. And we'll see. I mean, this is what I get anecdotally. The team's collecting data on this right now. And I'll have a better, I'll be headed down April and May, and I'll have a better handle on it by the end of that, because that'll be, you know, the time that those guys need to be chopping their trees already. And so if the younger guys aren't out there chopping, then they aren't going to be doing horticulture that year.
I'm wondering if you could, if there's anything in the literature, either empirical or theoretical, to which you could relate the findings about the flood, about the role in human evolution of the selection by periodic disaster, you know, as distinct from the sort of chronic problems of survival and reproduction. You know, what role do you think events like this have had in the past?
Well, I definitely think that the archaeological record shows significant evidence of a number of major disasters. And definitely if we look at the carbon isotopes, oxygen isotopes, we can tell that there are wild fluctuations in temperature and rainfall in like ice cores and things like that over the last centuries, and especially during critical periods in human evolution. And so that area isn't necessarily my specialty, but I would definitely think that that's been a strong selective pressure, and then that was likely one of the things that helped our ancestors with the larger brains that were able to deal with some of these changing environmental conditions in ways that other primates couldn't, that was likely one of the big things that helped shift humans. I mean, if you have a major, major selective pressure like natural disaster and you can't deal with that, then you're out the game.
So kind of related to that, one argument that's been made for our unusually long post-reproductive lifespan is the importance of information transfer. Mm-hmm. And in particular, at least the possibility that's been discussed, that what old people are really good for is black swan events, right? It's these rare, unpredictable, long time span between them, but devastating in their consequence. So, you know, in the in the tsunami in Aceh and the Indian Ocean, there are anecdotal reports of villages that survived because there were old people who said, oh, we know what to do when the ocean goes out like this, right? And the villages got wiped out. People just kind of wandered out onto the beach and said, well, look, all the mussels you can pick up, right? Because, you know, the water's not away.
Yeah.
And I'm curious whether, you know, I realize that the scope of the shamanic health project is enormous and the focus is very much on the biomedical aspect of it, but I'm curious whether you guys have looked at the sort of ethnography of differences in communities or even in families in terms of how well they coped with the change as a function of the presence of elderly individuals who might have seen something like this. I mean, if these are 100-year floods, then obviously there's nobody who's seen one on this magnitude before in any of these communities. But there may be old people who heard from their parents or their grandparents about events like this.
Yeah, so that's interesting. So Eric Schneider, who's a grad student at UCSB, he's done a lot of work looking at grandparents and that intergenerational transfer of knowledge. And that'd be interesting to see if he has any data on that. Because I think that it'd be hard to get at from the data we've collected thus far on the flood. Certainly, we collected data on whether you'd ever experienced a previous flood and if that flood was worse than this one. But one of the problems with that, at the time, that seemed like a good question. But in retrospect, it's kind of not because, you know, if you experienced a really bad flood before, you probably moved somewhere else. So maybe you still experienced this flood, but it's not nearly as bad because you knew to move your house away from the river. And so because we weren't asking those types of questions, I don't know if we'd be able to find out from the current data.
But
that's an interesting question.
Demographically, right? So, you know, all else being equal, you would think that having an elderly family member is a liability because their productivity is so reduced compared to younger individuals.
Mm-hmm.
But if they're a repository of valuable knowledge, then your net family outcome might be better rather than worse if you have one of those old folks around.
Yeah, that's a really great point. I'll look at that and see if we find an effect.
As an aging male, I think
on that optimistic note, we are at the end of our time, so thank you very much.
Thank you.